The latest book or the last book which has come out is Hangwoman. It's the translation of my Malayalam novel Arachar, which I wrote in 2012. I finished it because it was being serialized in a Malayalam weekly called Madhyamam. So afterwards it came out as a book in Malayalam, and it did very well in Malayalam. That book actually was an adventure, a kind of adventure, Hangwoman and its Malayalam original, because as one of our famous writers described it, it is a Bengali novel written by a Malayali, because the setting is in Bengal. All the characters except one are all Bengalis, and it is kind of an adventure in terms of its craft and narration too. So as a writer, I was taking a great risk. I was not sure whether I could finish it decently and with dignity. This my protagonist, Chetana Agritha Malik, is supposed to be the first hangwoman in India, in the history of India. But as you know, as per our rules, a man, only a man is considered for the post of hangman. So I had imagined a woman in that job, and that's the way it worked out. But the thing is that Chetana was always there. Actually, I wanted to write a novel about the women empowerment and the history of women in our country. So, but I was not sure of the backdrop or the profession or the background in which I should place that my heroine, that is Chetana. So Chetana was always there. Chetana was waiting to be born for such a long time. Until I came to know about the 2004 hanging, which happened in Calcutta. And suddenly I found out that this is what my Chetana is going to do. She is going to hang a man. And that's how it took shape. Then I wrote this in 2011. Actually, there was not much of planning or homework before that. It was basically a race against time, because I had committed to contribute a novel to the weekly Madhyamam in Malayalam. So its editor, Mr. P.K. Parakadava, was putting me in gunpoint, and he was demanding the novel within days. And so I had to take a decision, and I was quick to decide that I am going to write about Chetana as a hangwoman. So that's how it took shape. And once I started writing, I understood that there was nothing more to it, more than I thought I can write. And it was like a novel guiding me all the way to the gallows, and kind of I was kind of digging out the women who were buried in our history, because if you look at history and if you try to learn it in a scientific way, it's a serious way, you can see that women have been rendered invisible throughout history. Take the history of any revolution, take the history of any struggle. We won't hear about many women. We may think that, okay, all the women who lived in those days were happily sitting in their home while the men were out fighting, dying, shedding blood. But that's not the case, actually. The women were just wiped off from the history. They were not documented. They were not recorded. So I was trying to reconstruct the history, the stories of women who lived and fought in their own way all through the centuries. So that was what I was trying to do, and for that I needed a very logical and credible scenario to place them. And I thought this is one backdrop I should utilize. Because I decided that my protagonist, Chetana, is going to hang a man, I decided that the craft should be like a rope with many small strands woven together to form the main story. So that's the way the story is crafted, and that was helpful in many ways because I could plan the noose which I was going to place in the on the head of the on the neck of the man whom I was going to hang from the very beginning. So and I wanted to write a novel which was not expected from me as a woman, as a writer in Malayalam. So I had to find out a different technique to say the story, to say the many stories I wanted to tell in one story. So that's the way it's crafted. And if you read the book, you'll find that the story is basically about women. It's about the stories of women, the lives of women. And you'll see that no woman character is similar to another. There are so many women characters, but I have I was surprised after writing it that no one is similar to another. It took 53 weeks, maybe 60 weeks, with all the planning and rewriting and things. No, it was being serialized, and it took shape as I was writing, and the research, the planning, everything went on simultaneously. As I told, it was a race against time. I did an editing. Actually, the first serious editing I did for the book was after it was being serialized. Then in the book form, I did but it didn't need much editing. I was surprised to find that it was almost perfect by the end, and I had to trim down a little here and there. That was all. That was the most traumatic experience I ever had, because all these 53 weeks I have been carrying all these characters in my mind, and they were occupying my time, energy, and demanding my energy in such a way that I turned out to be a very disastrous person at the end of it. I became depressed, I was tired, I was irritated with each and everyone I came across, and it was the most difficult time in my life. I couldn't pardon others, I couldn't forgive others for even the silliest things they committed. I was so sensitive. I turned out to be a very different person whom I was not familiar with. And this was a tremendous experience looking back, because that's the way I found out what writing can do to my body, to my physique, and to my mind. So till then, we hear about writers who are suffering the agony, the pain. We hear a lot about this, the agony of writing, and one will wonder, oh, what is this big deal? What's such a big deal about it? Because you are sitting in a room and writing, you're just thinking, what do you mean by suffering in it? Because you are earning money and you have become famous in the end. But after writing Arachar, I would never think that way, because I know that what kind of physiological changes writing can bring in oneself. It developed. In the beginning, I was not sure about how to bring about the things I wanted to write on. But as I started writing, "Likhte likhte lau ho jaye," it's an advertisement. No? Just like that, in the process of writing, the story developed a lot. The characters became sharp. The vision and the mission was very clear. I think the story wrote me rather than I was writing the story. That was not easy for me as a woman living in Kerala, in a typical middle class family. My daughter was studying in 10th standard at that time. Though she was in boarding, she was kind of very tense and undergoing. She was living under great stress due to the board exams and all. And at that time, I was not aware of that, but a lot of pressure from the family, from outside, was on me, and nobody was aware of the kind of trauma I was undergoing at that time. Everyone thought, okay, till then, no, I wrote in a very tension-free way. You just give me an assignment and I'll deliver it on time without any fuss. I was very good with deadlines. Once you give a deadline, I will make sure that I deliver, I'll finish the assignment within that deadline. So nobody understood the kind of pressure and struggle I was taking. Even I was not aware of that. But once I started Arachar, it required a lot of concentration as well as a lot of research from my part, because I was writing about a very unfamiliar place, a very strange place, about strange people with strange customs. And I haven't lived Calcutta for long. I have just visited Calcutta once in 1998. That's the only background I had, that's the only connection I had, idea I had about Calcutta while I started penning this Araja. So once I started this, it was kind of it was demanding in many ways, because writing, looking life from the with the eyes of a person who was born and brought up in Calcutta was not easy for a person who have lived all her life in Kerala. So once I start writing, if I write something like Chetana washing clothes, then suddenly I'll feel terrible, because I'll start questioning myself whether will Bengalis also wash clothes the same way as Malayalis? How do they stand while washing the clothes? Are they sitting and washing, or are they standing and washing, or do they wash under the pipes? A number of questions spring up instantly, and I have to clarify, I have to verify, I have to cross check in every sentence. And so, and it was kind of very demanding, very challenging. And sitting in Kerala, I was not living in Calcutta, I was not in Calcutta while I was writing that. So sitting in Kerala and thinking about this and worrying about this was indeed kind of trauma. And I had to finish the chapter and give it on time for printing, and I had to cross check the facts, because I was very particular that there should not be any factual error once I write it, because by the time I had earned somewhat a very good reputation as a journalist, so I didn't want to stake that. And my family thought, okay, this is very simple, and as usual, it is going to be very simple, very easy for me and for them. But later on, I found out that it's not going to be very simple, but they were not aware of it, and they were not going to accept the fact that I was doing something serious. In fact, I hadn't trained them. I had never taught them that writing was such a painful process. It was difficult for me and for them too. Yeah, I visited Calcutta twice. I traveled around a bit. I walked along the streets. I talked to people. Then actually, most of the research which helped me to write this book was done online and through books. Luckily, we get books on each and every aspect of Bengali life in English. And that's something very kind of it's like a boon to non-Bengali readers, because I always say that if a non-Malayali wants to write a book on Kerala and write it through the eyes of a Malayali protagonist, it wouldn't have been that easy as it was for me, because you won't find many books on Malayali culture and Malayali way of life available in English. So if you go to if you search in Flipkart or Infibeam for Bengali streets or dishes or clothes, you can get any number of books, but that's not the case with Kerala. So all these books helped me a lot. There are many historical books available on each and every aspect of historical. There's a big book on Bengal partition alone. The books are of course costly, but they were very helpful to me. Then one thing which helped me was that most of the major newspapers have archives online. So I have gone through every day's, each and every day's paper from the archives, and it has helped me a lot in doing the research. Because once you read the newspapers, you know, you realize that they are the best documentations you have on people's lives.